Welcome to Everyday Faith Life. I'm Monsignor Jim Vlorn, joined by Sister Mary Alice Peel. In world news, after the first round of French presidential elections, the bishop stressed the importance of rejecting violence, defending the weak, and looking for the common good.
En une année, nous avons changé le visage de la vie politique française.
For me, it's the collapse of the parties. The parties clearly, with the Socialist Party at 8%, I think, we have never seen this. I can understand that people have had enough of traditional parties and want something else.
The Bishops Conference of France has issued a statement following the first round of the presidential voting, which saw Emmanuel Macron and Marine Le Pen emerge as the two candidates in the May 7th runoff election. Monsignor Olivier Rabideau-Dumas, the conference's secretary general, said the dignity of our society is recognized by the respect of the weakest of its members, from the beginning of their life to their natural end.
Monsignor Olivier continued, when some countries host millions of refugees, how could our country shrink from the prospect of welcoming and integrating tens of thousands of these victims? On the issue of European unity, on which the candidates differ sharply, he called for genuine adherence of the peoples of Europe to the European project, but also called for greater European respect for national identity, in accord with the principle of subsidiarity. Interesting dynamic going on here, because this is a hot race. God knows America knows hot races, right, for the presidential leader. And this principle of subsidiarity is an interesting political concept, don't you think?
It is, and of course we are having the same issue, aren't
we?
Exactly. You know, how much belongs to the state and how much belongs to the government.
Yeah.
And of course in Europe it's not just the individual country, but it's also how each of those countries now are experiencing the relationship within the union.
Yeah.
And I think that's so much a part of that conversation that we wouldn't, of course, have that problem here. But the subsidiarity is, of course, the same issue.
Very interesting. And the Bishops' Conference over there is involved in it, which is terrific, too.
Very good. Very good. Now, in Vatican news, security was tight as Pope Francis traveled to Egypt. But Vatican spokesman Greg Burke said there were no specific threats. Mr. Burke said security considerations are now an important part of planning for any papal trip, that we live in a world where it is now something that is part of life.
Mr. Burke continued, the pontiff would not make major concessions for safety. Pope Francis will travel in a normal car while he's in Egypt and will arrive in a golf cart to celebrate Mass in an outdoor stadium on Saturday, April 29th. The Pope, along with the Coptic Orthodox Pope Tewardos II, will visit the Church of Saints Peter and Paul in Cairo, which is the site of a 2016 bombing that killed 24 people.
Pope Francis released a message to the people of Egypt saying, I am truly happy to come as a friend, as a messenger of peace, and as a pilgrim to the country that gave more than 2,000 years ago refuge and hospitality to the Holy Family fleeing from the threats of King Herod. He continued, I am honored to visit the land visited by the Holy Family.
These visits, boy, sister, they always bring trepidation, you know, because we're always worried for the Holy Father. But he goes so sincerely and spiritually to be with the folk that are there. You got to say, you know, our prayers are with him and our hearts are with him, right?
And he truly believes that if his work is the work of the Spirit, and certainly we believe that,
sure,
then he will be protected.
Mm-hmm.
And it certainly seems that that's true. You're right. Every time we watch him in another country, you just, at every turn of that little car, you wonder. And remember when he made the wrong turn that time?
I got mobbed. I know.
So it is frightening.
Yeah.
But what a symbol of peace. And how these people in Egypt and they're suffering so there now, how wonderful it is for him to go there among them.
Stay with us all weekend, too. We'll have all of that coverage live. You'll be able to participate in the papal mass and all of the visits, too. It will be provided live by telecare. In other Vatican news, Pope Francis has joined the ever-growing TED community by giving his first ever TED talk. It was shown in Vancouver, Canada, and has now been translated into 22 languages. TED is a nonprofit devoted to spreading ideas, usually in the form of short, powerful talks of 18 minutes or less. TED began in 1984 as a conference where technology, entertainment, and design converged, and today covers almost all topics from science to business to global issues to faith in more than 100 different languages.
Pope Francis shared his own personal experience of coming from a migrant family, saying he doesn't know how he was so fortunate to not end up among today's discarded people. He said, "I myself was born in a family of migrants. My father, my grandparents, like many other Italians, left for Argentina and met the fate of those who are left with nothing. I could have very well ended up among today's discarded people, and that's why I always ask myself, deep in my heart, why them and not me?"
The Pope also spoke about the importance of technological advancements and the power of tenderness when dealing with others, something he witnesses every day. These TED Talks are really beautiful, and they're worth kind of looking up some of these things. We do a show here called Molloy Public Square 2.0, which uses the TED concept, these short talks that inspire reflection and discussion.
And they're very good. You know, if you go to a conference and there are many hot issues, and the conference can only cover maybe three or four of the major ones, then they do the TED Talks. And so people go around from one talk to the other, and 18-minute talks, 2 minutes to move, and you go to the next talk. And that gives you an opportunity to get up to date in many different areas.
Yeah, very valuable. In national news, in light of the recent gang violence on Long Island and across the country, U.S. Attorney General Jeff Sessions visited local, state, and federal law enforcement on Long Island to discuss new measures to try to stop the wave of slayings. He said, "Gangs are a symbol of a plague that is spreading across our country and into our communities," and continued that gang violence is one of the gravest threats to American safety.
"Over the past 16 months, gang violence is responsible for 15 homicides in Suffolk County. 8 of those killed were high school children. Earlier this morning, we spoke with Bishop John Barris, Bishop of the Diocese of Rockville Center."
The violence and the loss of young lives, the 4 young men who were found in a park in Central Islip, the young women who were murdered back in the fall. Our hearts continue to pray for their families, to pray for their beautiful souls. And the 1.6 million Catholics of Rockville Center, our parishes, we stand in solidarity with these families. And we open ourselves in this Easter season to the beautiful logic of the divine mercy and the streaming light that comes from the wounds of the risen Christ. That streaming light which touches the wounds of our families that have lost loved ones through gang violence, that touches the wounds of families who have members of their family involved in gangs. That has got to be a horrific cross for families. It's a time where, as a church, we are very present because we follow the logic of the Catholic Church's fundamental mission on earth is a mission a very strong, courageous mercy and compassion. When there's vacuums, when there are hurts or some sort of alienation within the family or in society, that's a breeding ground for gangs and membership in gangs and the spiral of violence that ensues. So also, as a church, we need to be so strong and loving and compassionate. We need to provide a wonderful formation for our young people, a formation in intimacy with God, an understanding that God is very real and central to our lives, and that everything about our lives, our Lord is with us and in us and moving us. Have a great confidence that God has a beautiful and unique plan for your life that harnesses every dimension of who you are in Christ, your gifts, your talents, your drives, your interests. Develop interests in a beautiful and powerful way, and be a person who stands up for the poor, who has a great emphasis on service, who is present to people who are suffering, and finds ways to serve, first of all, within our families. You know, and it's so important that our young people have a great love for their families, because as Pope Francis said, families transform the world and history. Every family has wounds, and so the compassion of Christ radiates through the wounds of families, making them stronger, making them more united in Christ and the mission of the church. They are our domestic churches. So I would just ask our young people to have a great love for their families and a great beautiful sense of communion with their parents, their brothers and sisters, their extended families. And in that way, that's the most beautiful laboratory to be in communion and mission with the rest of the church and society at large. I carry this funeral card of Jorge Tigre, one of the young men who lost his life in the Central Islip Park. We're called to be very strong in our formation of our young people in the Catholic faith and the opportunity to develop vibrant interests and passions in life. We are with the families who have lost their young sons and daughters to gang violence, and we're with families who have sons and daughters in gangs. It must be just so painful for these families to deal with this every day. We're with them as well. And so we open ourselves to the wounds of the glorified Christ, the light that streams from them, from the divine mercy, which touches every dimension of the gang violence problem in our communities and in our parishes. We open ourselves to being proactive and to working within the community to provide opportunities for young people to be very strong, very character-based, character-driven, so that they can be strong in their decisions in life and make vibrant contributions in the name of Jesus Christ in the church's mission to the world.
It's a beautiful context. Faith, solidarity, and family, where the church needs to be. And Bishop Barris did a yeoman's job there.
And also that emphasis on family and how important it is to recognize that term family often means a single parent. Mm-hmm. Or it may even mean a family where a young person lives with others who mm-hmm. are parent for them. I think that we have to recognize the brokenness of many of our families and also the strength within communities to try to build up those domestic churches. And I like using that terminology mm-hmm. because wherever one lives, there can be the domestic church, depending on who happens to be there. And in many of these communities, that, of course, is a reality.
Bishop Barris has released a statement that's available on drvc.org in regard to all this. I urge you to go there and give it a read and to continue to pray in this particular way to the divine mercy image of Jesus that his heart can pour upon our communities here on Long Island and across our country.
Now, in other national news, the Mercy Brown Bag Program offers food and assistance to senior citizens who are struggling to meet ends meet and struggling to afford medicine. Faced with rising costs, seniors choose to give up healthy food first. But this food truck aims to make it easier to lead a healthy lifestyle. Joining us via Skype is Krista Lucchesi, Director of the Mercy Brown Bag Program. Good morning, and thank you for being with us.
Good morning, thank you.
Well, tell us about this program and how it works.
Sure. For 35 years, we've partnered with the Sisters of Mercy and other community partners as a program of Mercy Retirement and Care Center to coordinate the distribution of nutritious groceries twice a month, free of charge, to seniors throughout our county. And our motto is seniors helping seniors. So with the help of over 500 volunteers, we bring that food in bulk that we have gathered from our community food bank, and we bring it right to the neighborhood where low-income seniors are living throughout our county.
And even more so than just an outreach, this really is a ministerial experience for those involved, right?
Absolutely. It is a wonderful way to break the isolation, to care for your neighbors, and a way to say thank you for all of the blessings that we have received as we reach out and care for all of the seniors who are suffering with food insecurity.
Now, when a senior picks up the food at the food truck, are they able to then prepare that food appropriately? How does that work with seniors?
Absolutely. So this new truck that was custom built, it has shelves that pop out of the sides. It transforms into a mini market. And then the seniors can choose. They shop for free for the groceries that they want. And then they have those recipes in their heads. We provide some recipes, and they take it to their apartments and homes and create it, a lot of times sharing it with their neighbors who they know are also in need. So it really builds community.
There are a number of new challenges facing seniors today all over our country. I know my dad is one of them, and there's a lot of new challenges. I mean, can you explain some of those?
Sure. We see food really as medicine because 50% of the diseases that are impacting older adults are connected to a lack of appropriate nutrition. And so we see struggles with seniors who are not able to get the food that keeps them well. And in those seniors, like 60% of them have a higher experience of depression because of that. 53% increase in heart attacks or 52% in asthma just because they don't know where the next meal comes from. So it's very hard for them. And we really see the retired seniors helping. And a 73-year-old Jean taught me just this week that God doesn't see retirement, God sees refirement. And all of us seniors making sure that our neighbors are not going to suffer with food insecurity.
That's a great, great program. And are others duplicating it? Are you aware of places that are using the program now?
So this is still a one of a kind, but we think that as it grows and we can serve thousands more seniors because of it, that we really believe God will use that and will be able to use these plans for this truck and have trucks all over the country or the world even.
The website is mercybrownbag.org. You can go there to find out more information. Thanks so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
God bless you and that wonderful ministry out in Oakland. Wow. Well, coming up next, should the Plan B pill, also known as the morning after pill, be available in vending machines along with your snacks and drinks? Find out more after this short break.
Fidelis Care is made of people who care.
People that are willing to go above and beyond.
Fidelis Care is compassion.
The mission of Fidelis Care is quality, affordable health care for all.
It doesn't matter who you are, how old you are, where you came from.
These programs are for everybody.
There's really no other organizations out there like us.
I love Fidelis. I love what it stands for.
It's a commitment by everyone to improve lives.
We're also out in the public showing that we're there and we care.
We care about people's health for a lifetime.
For a lifetime.
This is what Fidelis Care is made of.
Compassion. Commitment. Community. This is what we're made of.
This is what we're made of.
Welcome back to Everyday Faith Live. Professor Stephen Schneck, who's the director of the Institute for Policy Research and Catholic Studies at Catholic University of America, is about to retire this week. He reflects on three decades of politics and Catholic social teaching.
Stephen Schneck loves politics. He also loves Catholic points of view. For 33 years, the Washington policy wonk has been molding minds on the campus of the Catholic University of America. Now he's retiring.
So I love the deliberation about issues. I love the frothy media excitement about it all. I mean, so I've always loved politics.
Are you dying to use pepper spray on your relatives?
Behind that or beneath that is something else, and that is politics is the doing of civilization. It's not really just about who's ahead in the polls or who wins or who loses. Politics in the broadest sense is about building civilization.
In the classroom, Schnack acknowledges ancient thinkers and their effort to understand right from wrong.
Politics was always about morality. Socrates, in the dialogue Gorgias, describes politics as the art of the soul.
And in meditation are new opportunities.
Our hope was that we would, you know, be able to develop, this is the way that Father O'Connell talked about it, something like a Catholic think tank. Those were, you know, my marching orders. I'm very proud that the Institute has the attention of national policymakers. I'm also proud of the way that we've changed the debate on a number of topics, changed the language in which people talk about some public policy issues in the United States.
We wish him the best in retirement, but Professor Schnack has really given an awful lot to the Catholic University community and to this country, really.
Well, the country needs it, don't we?
Yeah.
I mean, when you hear people being talked down because they have a different point of view on a college campus, that's horrendous.
Yeah.
And so the more we can do to get the dialogue going again and to allow for a diversity of expression and an openness to listen to one another. Mm.
So important. A California university has come under fire this week for dispensing the abortion-inducing pill called the Plan B in a vending machine in a study room at the University of California, Davis. It's being called a wellness-to-go vending machine that includes this pill, among other items, such as condoms, tampons, pregnancy tests, and Advil. It's sort of hard to believe I'm even reading this story, right? It's just, that's incredible. Where are we?
It really is. Where are we is correct.
Yeah.
And yet, while this morning after pill, it's being abused, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm.
And young women are taking it, and then, of course, the next day after they take it, they're sorry they took it.
Sure.
When they realize what they've done, fortunately, there are ways of, if you get it fast enough, of undoing
it. Reversing it, yeah.
Reversing it. But the big problem here is that our young people are not respecting their bodies.
Mm.
They're not respecting them on so many levels. Even to take something like this pill is to not respect your body, never mind what you're doing to the person that you're creating.
Sure.
You know? So I think so much needs to be done. And fortunately, numbers and larger numbers of our young women are getting into this conversation,
mm-hmm.
and are recognizing that this direction is not helpful, is not healthy. We don't know all the facts yet, but we do know that it is not good for a young woman to be taking any of these types of pills.
And especially from a vending machine. My God, let's need some prayer here, that's for sure. Coming up next, a movie that teaches us how to forgive. After this short break.
Hi, I'm Lourdes Stephan, host of Univision's Sal y Pimienta. Cancer doesn't just change the way you feel, it changes the way you look. From losing your hair, even your eyebrows, to changes in your skin and nails, cancer treatment can rob you of your confidence and self-esteem. But Look Good, Feel Better changes all that. More than 800,000 women have learned how to address the appearance side effects of cancer treatment through our workshops. Visit lookgoodfeelbetter.org to find a free workshop near you. Let Look Good, Feel Better help you feel like you again.
This is my new best friend, Esther. She might look like any normal, playful puppy, but Esther's being raised to become a canine companion for independence assistance dog for a person with a disability. To get there, she needs lots of loving care and attention, plenty of exercise, and good eating habits so that she can live a long and healthy life for her future family. Visit CCI.org or call 1-800-572-BARK. Raise a puppy, change a life. You can make a world of difference in the life of a person with a disability.
Welcome back to Everyday Faith Live. It's said that forgiveness should not be denied to anyone, and that is exactly what the new film by Spanish director Juan Manuel Cotello wants to convey in The Greatest Gift.
I think it will be very encouraging to see that there are people, and they are ordinary beings, who have asked for forgiveness for grave things they did, and those that have forgiven the grave things they did to them, so that any spectator can think when leaving the cinema, I too can ask for forgiveness, I too can forgive.
In the film, people that manage to change their life thanks to forgiveness are featured, even after living in extremely cruel situations. Not to forgive means to live bound to hatred and grudges that aren't positive. Instead, they drag down your life. People say to me, I do not understand how you can forgive those who almost killed you. I say, I don't do it for them. I do it for me.
Lloré. Hasta que pensé, yo dije, ¿yo qué hice de mi vida con tanto odio?
¿Hay algún modo de romper esa espiral de odio y de tristeza? ¿Se puede mirar con paz a la persona que mató o que ordenó matar a tu propia hija? ¿Es posible amar a un enemigo?
Jesucristo viene a la tierra para...
Jesus Christ came to earth to forgive us and open the way to heaven. Allusions to Jesus Christ's forgiveness in the gospel are many. How often shall I forgive my brother? 70 times 7. When someone slaps you on the cheek, offer them the other. Love your enemies. Forgive them, for they do not know what they do. If you do not forgive your enemies, you will not participate in the kingdom of heaven.
For this movie to hit theaters, they have launched a crowdfunding campaign. Anyone can contribute to this defense of forgiveness, which reaches out to everyone in the entire world.
Anyone can join this project from home, from a mobile phone, or even from a computer screen by entering our website at www.infinitoplusone.org. They can make a donation that can be from 1 euro to larger amounts, and as a symbol of gratitude, we offer small gifts to reward that donation.
Etymologically, the word forgiveness means a great gift. As this motion picture explains, the best gift is forgiveness, both towards others and also towards ourselves.
We're talking extreme forgiveness here. I mean, my God, having to be ordered to kill your own daughter and things like that to forgive that person. That's incredible.
Absolutely. And as the woman said, you know, there's so much hatred then. Oh. And to have to try to let all that go as you enter into that act of forgiveness, it's so healing.
It's incredible, man.
Hundreds gathered to mourn William Tully, the FDNY firefighter from Bethpage, who died on April 20th, 2017, after he fell five stories from the roof at a Ridgewood apartment building, where a minor blaze was caused by burning incense left unattended.
Cardinal Timothy Dolan, Archbishop of New York, and Bishop John Barris, Bishop of the Diocese of Rockville Center, were among those who attended his funeral service Thursday, which was attended by over 10,000 people. The 14-year veteran is survived by his wife and 8-year-old daughter, who's preparing to receive First Communion, his brother, and both of his parents. Our thoughts and prayers, of course, are with the Tully family. Great people, and everybody I know who knows them say they're just wonderful people, so we're praying for them, right?
Absolutely, and for that little girl.
Yeah, without a doubt, right? All right, thank you, everybody, for being with us today. For Sister Mary Alice Peel, I'm Monsignor Jim Vlaunen. From all of us at Telecare, remember, keep the everyday faith live. Have a great week, everybody, and God bless you.